Hi, everyone. I'm TJ Demos, and it's great to be here. My presentation is called Racial Capitalocene, Ecology and Abolition. How has contemporary art, including British formations, reconfigured how we understand terms like ecology, environment, and climate in ways that expand the horizons of ecocritical speculative discourse, its socio-political stakes, and its resonances with socio-environmental practices more broadly? In this, there's no simple category, I think, of British art, owing to transnational formal genealogies, conceptual affiliations, geopolitical solidarities, and diasporic and migratory practices, rendering the national as an umbrella term largely artificial, just as natural forces, the second key term in the present conference, is irreducibly plural, heterogeneous, and global, as we learn in extensive Anthropocene research that has inextricably joined natural and cultural histories to multiscalar frames, as much as deep, expansive geological times, even with geographically and historically differentiated effects. Approaching the state of the field, then, by first questioning the coherence of states and fields, I'd like to discuss speculative and artistic approaches to ecology, environment, and climate, terms that, at their most ambitious conceptualization in certain creative constellations, are insistently connective, tentacular, to use Donna Haraway's terms, entangled in Karen Barad's, and intersectionalist, with many lessons aesthetically, politically, methodologically, and historically for us to consider. Let's first look at the Otolith Group's Infinity Minus Infinity, the London-based collective's 2019 film linking racial capitalism with the colonial genocide perpetrated during the racial capitalocene's beginnings in the 16th century's conquest of the Americas, the racial capitalocene being a term used by Françoise Vergès as well. Between 1492 and 1610, the conquest brought the destruction of some 50 million Amerindians, leading to massive afforestation and a noticeable drop in atmospheric carbon measurable in the stratigraphic record. Infinity's expansive genealogy builds further on this political geology to include the so-called hostile environment of recent British immigration policy, especially that affecting the Windrush generation of migrants living both in the afterlife of slavery and in the post-colonial wake of empire. The Windrush generation referring to those Commonwealth citizens arriving in the United Kingdom from Caribbean islands between 1948 and 1971, only to have their residency and indeed their British citizenship status questioned and even rejected decades later by recent British migration policies. The film's cinematic allegory traces these complex historical networks as mediated by performance, dance, recital, and historical truth-telling spoken by figures who appear as trans-temporal deities, as you can see in this still. Indeed, one central character appears many-headed, an Indo-futurist trope signaling multiple realities, or a future of many futures, in a time-splitting act of metaphysical and even cosmopolitical import. Through these means and more, the video choreographs what the artists call a choreopoetics, creatively drawing on African-American playwright and poet Entezaki Shange's model, indebted to the Black Arts movement in the US, of a multimedia aesthetic of creative collective speech geared toward emotional impact, which the Otolith Group puts to task against the calculative machinery of abstract carbon statistics. Infinity's script is drawn from diverse sources, including the writings of Jamaican poet Una Marson, Martinican philosopher and poet Edouard Glissant, the Brazilian sociologist Denise Ferreira da Silva, and British geographer Catherine Youssef.
The invasion of Europeans in the Americas resulted in a massive genocide of the indigenous population, leading to a decline from 54 million people to approximately 6 million. This led to a massive reduction in farming and the regeneration of forests and carbon uptake, leading to an observed decline in Antarctic ice cores, of CO2 in the atmosphere.
Even from this brief entrance, we get a sense of the expansive basis of the socio-environmental as an innovative conceptual category in the Otolith Group's multiscalar and multi-temporal cinema. The space-time conditions of ecology in its capaciousness function as a structure of relationalities, what I call ecology as intersectionality, which has emerged as a compelling aesthetic and conceptual methodology of recent eco-critical practice. Building off the insights of political ecology, this approach, which I've written about previously as in this essay in Panorama, this approach conceptualizes aesthetic practices that model ecology as tentacular and entangled, as when insisting on the inseparability between environmental matters of concern and socio-political and economic frameworks of justice and injustice. Intersectionality emerges from a long history of African-American activism and anti-racist, anti-sexist politics from writers such as Sojourner Truth or Anna Julia Cooper and Alexandra Kollontai to bell hooks, Claudia Jones and the Cumbahee River Collective and Angela Davis. More recently codified in the Black feminist legal theory of Kimberly Crenshaw, it's understood within contemporary struggles for indigenous decolonization, within anti-capitalist organizing, and refuses to divide overlapping systems of oppression tied to race, class, gender, sexuality, ability, and so on, thereby challenging the essentialization of one or another term in isolation. I argue that ecology functions as an interlinking site of indissoluble relationality between forces and materialities that are co-determined and co-constituted by interaction with these multiple fields, or better, intraaction, in the sense posited by Karen Barad, whose feminist science studies theorization of quantum field theory rejects the separateness and purity of originary categories. Just as carbon pollution, for instance, is highlighted by the environmentalist organizations like Extinction Rebellion, materializes differential socio-political impacts, and there is indeed no way to account for toxicity outside of its disparate consequences, so too does economic inequality produce distinctive vulnerabilities to environmental injustice, as underlined within recent Black Lives Matter protests. With the siloing of issues, whether eco-art models a tendency to isolate and celebrate the non-human realm in an effort to escape anthropomorphism or anthropocentrism, or in mainstream environmentalism's tendency to abstract atmospheric carbon from its actual socio-ecological impacts, or even social justice art's foregrounding of social oppression disconnected from the more than human, we risk committing epistemic violence, which can translate into the extremes of exclusion in colorblind white environmentalism, or green capitalism's omission of social justice, all detached from social and economic formations and politics at a time of expanding inequalities, something that I also see in the work of Olafur Eliasson. In our emergency times of disastrous environmental transformation and militarized climate control, exemplified in Forensic Architecture's recent work called Triple Chaser, and the globalization of the use of tear gas as a form of militarized atmospherics, it's urgent to consider these entanglements, where biogeophysical ecologies merge in precise and differentiated ways with socio-political and economic ones, so as to challenge white supremacy, the militarization of everyday life, creeping ecofascism, apocalyptic populism, as well as mass extinction. With the time I have, I'd like to consider a few examples of resistant practices, which are also intervening in documentary and moving image art, where representational aesthetics combine with conceptual and historical resonances in ways that reveal new potential futures, leaving the present state of the field and our understanding of natural forces altered in turn. With her compelling contribution to indigenous futurism, Toronto-based Thirza Jean Cuthan's Reclamation from 2018 documents what's to come. Premised upon a mass settler exodus to Mars in the near future, the short video portrays a broken, abandoned earth left to indigenous peoples who freed from extractive devastation, toxic racism, repressive heteronormativity, and the endless wars and violence of capitalist property relations, subsequently begin the work of post-colonial environmental restoration. Delivered through familiar documentary tropes, the piece showcases interviewees discussing their newfound lives with contextualizing footage of dystopian landscapes presented in the evidentiary mode with a handheld camera's reality effects. Its futurism unleashes radical formal possibilities in both decolonizing time, reversing the conventional documentary's ties to pastness, projecting the that which has been into what's to come, and generating forces of creation beyond the mimetic doubling of reified and colonial realities. It thereby lays an explosive charge in the present through a performative imagination, rendering the future as disruption from colonization as much as capitalism, that much more probable.
I was scared that they had done so much to this planet that there'd be no way for us to fix it. It's a lot cleaner. Yeah, it is. It's a lot cleaner. Like, it smells good here, Nate. It smells like nature. Great. It smells like we're making a difference here. We've cleaned a lot of this area up.
This is what we do with cleaning up things. We make sure the area is safe for barefoot walking, pretty much. And this is just one of our bins we have. We filled up approximately 500,000 bins. Since white people left, full-time job is cleaning up out these pukes. You see some garbage, you pick it up. That's what everybody does around here.
Here, documentary figures as the creative practice of chronopolitics, designating the politics of time as much as the time of politics, both implying there's nothing natural or inevitable about how we organize temporality. With it, we confront the challenge of thinking ecology's relationalities through the spectrum of temporality and are asked to consider ecologies of time radically other to, for instance, settler colonial time or the implacable linear progressivism of capitalist realism and their multiply excluded peoples. Dates matter, as Zoe Todd and Heather Davis argue in relation to Anthropocene narratives. And so too is temporality a modality of ecology. As such, documentary provides a technology for revealing portals into futures alternative to the now, recalling Arundhati Roy's description of the current pandemic conjuncture. Structural breakdown discloses newfound opportunities for a creative transformation of what's yet to be. Passing through that portal, we can cast a barrier of eternity between the barbarism of the present and the justice of the hereafter. The stakes are indeed enormous. We're caught in a situation in which time has been colonized, racialized, and economized, generating what Black Quantum Futurism, the Afrofuturist collective based in Philadelphia, term the temporal ghettos of racial capitalism, unfolding over hundreds of years where the master's clockwork universe unevenly distributes spatiotemporal mobility, agency, and determination. Just as material inequality reigns globally, we succumb as well to an endless present of capital's calculative machinery, seemingly but falsely, rendering resistance pointless. Time operationalized as such recalls what Jasper Puar terms prehensive futurity, a chronology that, in her words, inevitabilizes a desired unfolding. We cannot get out of the present because we are tethered to the desired future. Past, present, and future feel somewhat futile as descriptions of temporal distinctions, according to Puar. Conventional documentary, as well as corporate media, tends to reify that time trap. Cuthand's reclamation, a decolonization of time as much as of space, poignantly contests dominant ecologies of temporality, including techno-libertarianism's prehensive futurity and its colonialism of land, the economy, and the infosphere of communications. It's as if its vision of what's to come is a foregone conclusion, as when the billionaire tech entrepreneur Elon Musk, who in a recent response to charges of complicity in the anti-democratic political takeover in Bolivia, in part to secure lithium reserves for global markets, including for his own Tesla cars and SpaceX project, tweeted, "We will coup whoever we want. Deal with it." Performing the hegemonic futurity to which we're all tethered, Musk pushes extractive colonial capitalism into any and all territories, including outer space, as well as into infinity. Thankfully, that right-wing coup has been reversed, though, in recent Bolivian elections. Still, Musk's futurism entails destroying the lands, waters, and life chances of frontline communities worldwide, producing a growing class of the indebted, vulnerable, and disenfranchised, subjected to all manner of police violence, incarceration, and growing deaths of despair, on top of mounting climate disasters, existential insecurity, and pandemic emergency. Given the resulting desperation, our forlorn present has triggered blunt expressions of what we might call time resistance, like Alicia Wormsley's "There Are Black People in the Future," placed recently in halting all cap white letters on a black billboard in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, as well as on various artistic objects, sculptural pieces, installations, and in films. Wormsley's revolt against her people's being defutured elaborated in a proleptic sense of the present impending, a chronopolitics of prefiguration, resonates with the ongoing battles over public monuments and their removals. These highlight the otherwise suppressed violence of colonialism and slavery and their aftermath, past and present conflicts over heritage inextricable from the very social production of the future, which also index the stakes of documentary today. Ecologies of time are fraught and conflictual, much like varieties of environmentalisms. Who has the right to produce the future? Radical futurisms have arisen in recent years to assert the means of production of the future, articulated through speculative visions of times to come. And this has to do with the current research project and book that I'm working on right now. As witnessed internationally in the formation of creative practices pledged to decolonizing the not yet, these rescue open potentiality from the grips of capitalism's algorithmic capture, its technogenic determination, its biosecurities of control. Building on the precedents of Afrofuturisms of decades past, when Black sci-fi and musical experimentation projected an emancipated technological presence in years ahead, as historicized and fictionally dramatized in Black Audio Film Collective's film, The Last Angel of History from 1996, these practices now generate new configurations of documentary in multiple sectors, including those of indigenous futurisms, trans and queer futurisms, multi-species and eco-socialist futurisms, and still more. They're also insistently intersectionalist, where ecologies form webs of entanglement that bear simultaneously on material circumstances, environmental conditions, and socio-political and economic relations, entanglements that also lean on lessons of past environmental justice struggles that refuse to isolate natures from cultures in their culturally differentiated and historically specific formations. Another such modeling is Black Quantum Futurism's documentary Chronopolitics, which materialize video assemblages and photomontages that unleash the forces of radical reversibility and retrocausality. They target time zones that keep racialized bodies locked in oppressive cells fortified by all manner of temporal encasements and holds, unchanging pasts, presence of indolence and criminality, defutured voids of non-existence. From these, they break out. As with their 2019 video, Black Space Agency Training Video, overlapping images blur into illegibility. Shapes mirror and mutate, mimicking soundscapes filled with echoes and reverberations, all emanating from a deep psycho-environmental space of traumatic collective memory in what Sadia Hartman terms the afterlife of slavery, and in the recent past of housing segregation. Foregrounded as well in the experimental music of BQF member Kame Ayewa, also known as Moor Mother, sonic elements perform, deform, and reform like their visual analogs as so many fugitive beings, oftentimes ripped and perhaps liberated from appropriated sources of violence. Indeed, some are sourced from deadly encounters with anti-Black police brutality, as with the sound piece, The Afterlife of Events, Time Distortion from 2016, with its torturous audio mixed with brutalist electronica, representing Sandra Bland's violent arrest by police in Texas before her suspicious death in jail in 2015. Explains BQF, we believe that astrological events are reversed and act retrocausally from the cosmic future to influence present events that will be subsequently written on the fabric of the past by light and sound, such as an eco-temporal recipe for futurism's transformative power in the present. With Black Space Agency and associated collages, BQF grafts the techno-optimism of past space travel, dramatized in astronaut iconography and mirrored helmets reflecting Black faces, onto newspaper clips reporting unfulfilled urban housing justice dreams, resonating with the goals of BQF's Community Futures Lab in North Philadelphia, where member Rashida Phillips works as a housing rights lawyer. Their cultivation of space agency is juridico-political, geographical, astronautical, as much as environmental, aesthetic, and temporal. Indeed, the challenge is how to constellate their pulsating lights and sounds to gain the future they want, ripped from the contradictions of racialized inequalities in resource allocation, as their video quotes Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. as valid today. Again, think of the scandal of Elon Musk as it was in 1966. He says, there is a striking absurdity in committing billions to reach the moon where no people live, while the densely populated slums are allocated minuscule appropriations. Cue Gil Scott-Heron's 1970 classic, Whitey on the Moon. Those uneven spatiotemporal geographies or lunographies are also upended in Cuthand's reclamation, resonating with the resounding world historical project of decolonization as demanded by indigenous formations like Idle No More, and more recently, the Red Nation. For them, decolonization represents the abolition of dominant economic arrangements and socio-political systems organized around extraction and exploitation, bringing to an end more than 500 years of colonial history and making way for futures of collective emancipation. The video's performative power constructs its subjective viewership, an emancipated people to come on land evacuated of oppressors, a red nation rather than a red planet, which bears on how solidarity might operate today, particularly in settler colonial territories like North America, including in artistic practice. Eve Tuck and Wayne Yang have argued that non-native solidarity with indigenous emancipation must avoid what they term settler moves to innocence or goodwill ally gestures that practice the metaphorization of decolonization by denying its essential meaning, the return of land and sovereignty to indigenous peoples, as if indigenous environmentalism would have much to do with decarbonization alone. Without anchoring those superficial gestures in the latter's radical meaning, metaphorizing acts which facilely extend decolonization to this or that, whether decolonizing the university or sexuality, as necessary as those also are, problematically attempt to reconcile settler guilt and complicity and rescue settler futurity, in the words of Tuck and Yang. Ultimately, for them, settler accomplices can only accept an ethic of incommensurability when it comes to solidarity, which proposes an ecology of political belonging. That means, in their words, relinquishing settler futurity, abandoning the hope that settlers may one day be commensurable to native peoples, which in turn requires an understanding of uncommonality that uncoalesces coalition politics. I'm aware that indigeneity proposes something maybe completely different in the British context, where natalist citizenship can oppose xenophobic alienation, but perhaps the radical politics of uncommonality might nevertheless have useful overlaps transnationally. Accepting uncommonality leaves us recourse to alternatives like those presented in radical Black praxis, dedicated to the undercommons and to a permanent fugitivity, as elaborated by people like Fred Moten and Stefano Harney, where the refusal of property and possession of land as much as conventional subjectivities is the ethical truth of emancipated social experience and the only possible basis for decolonial solidarity. That's exactly what Cutan's radical futurism offers to non-Indigenous viewers via documentary form, a subjective non-place, dispossession and permanent fugitivity. And this precisely because the decolonized what's to come is devoid of settler colonialism's oppressive subjects. With the video, non-Indigenous viewers experience their own disappearance. They become accomplices in the abolishing of whiteness as a structure of racial division and colonial oppression. That said, one might argue conversely that de-metaphorizing decolonization shouldn't dead end in the uncoalescing of coalition politics, but rather reveal new pathways of solidarity on that basis. Indeed, there's an urgent need for such alliances now more than ever, given present hyper-partisanship, social media atomization, and ethno-nationalist reaction. And even with the recent win of Joe Biden and Kamala Harris in the US, it's not going to put an end, as many argue, to those conditions that gave rise to Trumpism in the first place. This in order to build collective power to disrupt the constancy of colonial capitalist violence that harms us all, if differentially, socio-politically and economically. Writing from yet another radical indigenous perspective, Nick Estes of the Red Nation, argues that indigenous futurity is and must be universal. It isn't just for indigenous people, it is essential for the very existence of life on the planet. Universal less in the Eurocentric imperial sense, but rather in the insurgent universality of, for instance, Max Tumba's recent work, perhaps. What's required for Estes is a social revolution that turns back the forces of destruction, uniting indigenous and non-indigenous people in common struggle against capitalism and colonialism alike. Instead of or re-coalescing alliances of difference, another option is building solidarity through differences abolition, which documentary might also abet. At this speculative limit is, again, the Otolith Group's film, Infinity Minus Infinity. With Denise Ferreira da Silva, the artists speculate about a blackness beyond capture, an infinity beyond infinity, in the place of the subjectivity long denied to those of African diaspora by the European Enlightenment modernity. Documentary is consequently keyed to a future indeterminate and ultimately uncapturable zone of decolonized fugitive. Ferreira da Silva discusses blackness as anti-matter, as negative life. That is life that has negative value, instrumentalized historically by Europe's universal measure in defining whiteness as its counterpoint and the height of self-actualizing reason. The latter, fortified by racial oppositions gained through colonization and enslavement, with all of the sociological, economic, and representational violences that were cause and consequence of that inequality, including a long history of documentary anthropology. From its negative use value to a white reason and the dialectics of race, blackness in Ferreira da Silva's deconstruction opens onto indeterminacy, topologically connected to the infinite and uncontainable, approximated in Infinity Minus Infinity by turning the ears, eyes, and fingernails of figures into corporeal portals onto other worlds. This is accomplished through a kind of biopolitical montage in which bodily orifices and surfaces provide screens of videos within videos, a topology that reveals ever new scenes from the racial capitalocene, the geological epoch shaped by colonial capital and slavery, offering a more precise descriptor than the Anthropocene. With references to Shange's radical choreopoetics, also Julia Dash's cinematography, specifically her Four Women video set to the eponymous soundtrack by Nina Simone from 1974, and Sadia Hartman's writings on the choral as a mode of revolutionary collective dreaming and emancipatory storytelling. Infinity is an experiment, ultimately, in Black feminist choreopoetics. And I'd like to thank Kojo Eshun for sharing his thoughts on the piece with me. Defining a documentary of allegorical immensity, the film culminates as its five-headed entity speculates about an eventual future resolve of liberation, though only when those myths have been incorporated one into another and recognized as constituent parts of the before and afterlife of slavery and the never-ending colonial project. One such constituent myth of this deep history is what Chris Manjapra has recently termed necrospeculation. That is the economics of racial capitalism that records and manages the living dead surrounding post-emancipation finance. Infinity cites Her Majesty's Treasury and its infamous Surprising Friday Fact tweet of February 9th, 2018, that explained how millions of you helped end the slave trade through your taxes. Did you know? In 1833, Britain used £20 million, 40% of its national budget, to buy freedom for all slaves in the empire. The amount of money borrowed from the Slavery Abolition Act, it continues, was so large that it wasn't paid off until 2015, which means that living British citizens helped pay to end the slave trade. Except they didn't. The sum, $17 billion in today's value, was rather dispersed to compensate slavers for the loss of their human property, paid by taxes, including from those descendants whose ancestors survived slavery, and distributed to more than 44,441 slave-owning claimants, many likely the ancestors of today's political class and economic elite. And the ready cash to carry out this necromantic transubstantiation of slaves, that's again in Manjapra's words, slaves that are living, absent, and dead, into money occurred through the raising of a massive loan by the British government in 1835 that the British state continued to pay for almost two centuries, ending only in 2015. Not only was slavery not ended, it continued in the notorious apprentice system of forced labor, nor was the payout motivated by the ethics of abolition exactly, but rather as a mode of racial capitalist speculation. Not surprisingly, the tweet was deleted within hours. Yet, of course, its financial logic lives on, transmuting into the so-called hostile environment used by the British government as part of its dissuasive anti-migrant and more exactly anti-Black political, economic, military, and cultural infrastructure, as announced by Theresa May in 2012, when she stated that her aim as Home Secretary under David Cameron was to create here in Britain a really hostile environment for illegal migration, inspiring a broad and generalized anti-migrant legislative and administrative atmosphere in Britain, peaking with the Windrush scandal. What I'm interested in here is with these projects is how their diverse approaches to aesthetic practice all disarticulate and reconfigure terms like atmosphere, climate, and environment as more than abstract categories of non-human natures. Instead, they become insistently socio-ecological, biopolitical, necro-speculative, dense entanglements of politics, economics, and technology as much as biology, chemistry, and geology. This is not a simple matter of political perspective or of a social art history of association and metaphor that draws distinct fields of meaning together. Rather, it necessitates the practice of what Donna Haraway calls sensible materialism, where past colonial and extractive violence provide ongoing and determining forces within social life today, forces that play a palpable role in defining the present in ways that can't be forgotten, repressed, or separated out without enacting epistemic violence. As a site where aesthetics and environment cross, sensible materialism grounds the analysis of intersectionalist ecology. In her book, In the Wake on Blackness and Being, Christina Sharp considers anti-Blackness as total climate, suggesting a resonant phase shift in the conceptualization of climate emergency today. She points to the infamous history of the 1781 Zong atrocity, here represented by Turner's The Slave Ship from 1840. When that British ship's captain opted to throw 130 slaves overboard and subsequently cash in on insurance claims after running low on drinking water on the open seas owing to navigational errors. It's another socio-environmental example of necro-speculation, where the human and the natural enter into financial speculation. In her discussion of the case, Sharp references the science of what she calls residence time, the period it takes a substance to enter and leave the ocean, which for human blood and sodium is some 260 million years. The Zong's past, in other words, is still very much present. And for Black people, everything is now. It is all now, she explains, quoting Toni Morrison. Sharpe's discussion provides a methodological lesson for environmental studies and thinking about terms like atmosphere and climate that helps avoid the emergency thinking that would abandon history in the production of a future-oriented politics environmental or emergency. For instance, with some varieties of environmentalism today, such as how, and this brings to mind how groups like Wretched of the Earth have criticized Extinction Rebellion recently.
Then you sliced into me, examining my parts for all heroes of the future. You will find traces of compacted carbon compressed within the cells of the whole.
Similarly, when infinity utters the phrase, I can't breathe, the echoes spiral out in innumerable waves of anti-Black police violence, from Eric Garner's murder by police in 2014 to George Floyd's in 2020, where vulnerability to premature death owes as much to racist police violence as to the disproportionate proximity of communities of color to toxicity and landfills and hazardous waste, to inferior housing, pestilence, and urban impoverishment, leading to pre-existing medical conditions. We know from recent environmental justice sociology and breathing space that breathing spaces are racialized geographies, and that race and class inequalities are experienced in elemental ways in relation to air, water, and soil, where, generally speaking, Blacks and whites actually breathe different air, as Lindsay Dillon and Julie C. explain. We also know from the scandal in Flint, Michigan, that they drink different water. So how else to comprehend political ecology and its visual cultures in a present marked by the racialized deaths of breathlessness, but through an intersectionalist ecology, where there's nothing equal about access to air, bodily security, environmental health, and resources, where hostile environments themselves determine psychogeographies, racial atmospherics, climates of anti-Blackness and white supremacy, as well as ecologies of inequality. We know that this is part of a long history of Anthropocene biopolitics and necropolitics founded on the extraction of geopower for colonizers through slavery and the genocide of indigenous peoples, as Catherine Yusuf states in Infinity, drawing on her book, A Billion Black Anthropocenes or None, and pursuing a line of questioning that is another form of sensible materialism. She asks, what does it mean when we say Black Lives Matter? What kind of matter are we talking about? What histories of matter? What kind of geophysics is this? What color is the flesh of geology? Reverberating with Cuthand's reclamation, as well as BQF's multi-layered chronopolitics, Infinity Minus Infinity and its performative documentary ultimately proposes something like an abolitionist double negative, both doing one, catalyzing a disidentification, not only from white supremacy, but also from the very logic of racial difference. And two, compelling the nullification of those very systems, the legal and economic institutions, the techno-social and educational infrastructure, the effective and aesthetic practices that have reproduced the racial capitalocene historically and into the present. It's only appropriate then that the Otolith Group, in seeking to grant aesthetic form to this complex movement of a deeply historical futurism, find recourse in the imagery of two black holes colliding, creatively adopting a recent computer simulation from the California Institute of Technology that shows that awesome astronomical event detected for the first time ever by the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. Roughly 30 times the mass of the sun, each black hole contains a gravitational singularity wherein space-time curves infinitely, a natural force that leaves nothing as it was. The film operates then in the space-time between those two black holes. After a past of unforgivable debt in the afterlife of slavery and facing a future filled with indeterminacy beyond reified difference, its many portals reveal a not yet of radical disruption from a history that must be obliterated but never forgotten. At its best, current speculative documentary, and more widely, socio-environmental aesthetic practice, unleashes cosmopolitical force and provides the building blocks, forms, events, affects, poetics of new worlds, other environments, wayward climates. The challenge remains to organize the social movements to bring them into actuality. Thank you.